It was a clinical trial, and the focus first was to show that, provide evidence that audiology best practices as a way of delivering the hearing aids was in fact efficacious. That means it provided benefit compared to somebody who's not getting a functional hearing aid or a placebo. That had never been done before, and so that was one of the key pieces. And in fact, hearing aids do provide significant improvement and benefits compared to a placebo. The other thing that was emerging from this workshop was that that audiology best practices model had been in existence for quite a while, and yet still only 20% of those who could get help from hearing aids were actually going to the clinic and getting hearing aids. So looking at alternative ways of providing hearing aids to older adults, different service delivery models, was one of the other main objectives of this study. Well, I focused mainly on the service delivery model, and there I think the fact that using this kind of gold standard for how to do clinical research, a clinical trial, double-blinded, randomized, placebo-controlled, all those are important aspects of it. So it's kind of like the highest standard of clinical trial. Hearing aids were demonstrated to provide measurable benefits in older adults. That was true for audiology best practices, and it was largely true for over-the-counter. There were slight differences in favor of audiology best practices, but they would not be considered major differences, at least for the outcome measures that were obtained. So I think that's one of the main findings. The other thing I haven't mentioned at all is that we also looked at the impact of the purchase price. So we had two different prices that we wanted it, because the idea originally with coming up with over-the-counter was that the devices would be less expensive. Part of the price that you pay when you go to an audiologist and you go through physician clearance and you go through all these things is that in the end, you're paying more in professional fees to get the hearing aid. And so we picked two different prices that were kind of what we thought representative of those two different models. $3,600 for a pair of hearing aids is kind of was representative at the time of audiology best practices, and $600 was a best guess at maybe what somebody might pay in an over-the-counter. So a 6-to-1 difference in price from $600 to $3,600. And we decided to, even though the argument would be, well, you wouldn't have the lower price with audiology best practices, and you wouldn't have the higher price with the consumer decides over the counter approach, we decided to include all combinations, partly because there was no prior research looking at price. And so we really didn't know which way to expect it to go. And if we would have seen a difference, we wouldn't really know, was it because the consumer chose the hearing aids themselves, or was it because they paid a lower price for their devices? But by including all combinations of service delivery model, audiology best practices, and consumer decides, and purchase price, $600 and $3,600, we could actually tease out how much the service delivery mattered and how much the price mattered. So there were three different branches. After they had their initial hearing evaluation, they were randomly assigned to one of three groups, placebo, audiology best practices, or the consumer decides is what we called it, CD. So our study was referred to as ABCD, audiology best practices or consumer decides. And in both the placebo and audiology best practices, they then worked with the audiologist to fit the hearing aid, fine-tune it for the right response on their ears. They had a 45 to 60 minute hearing aid orientation session with the audiologist after it was fit that included how to take care of it, how to put it in and out, how to take the batteries in and out. For the consumer decides, they were escorted to a small room and they watched a video for about 10 minutes that overviewed what they were going to go through. They then followed those same instructions in some printed binders. In all three groups came back 6 weeks later after they wore the hearing aids, and then they did the outcome measures, and we asked them whether they wanted to purchase or whether they were likely to purchase the hearing aids at that point. That also was one of the differences between the three different branches. The audiology best practices, I think, was about 81% of those when asked at that follow-up session said that they were likely to purchase the hearing aids, but it was more like 56% of the consumer decides group that decided to purchase them, and even fewer, about a third of the placebo participants were interested and indicated at that point that they would be likely to purchase their hearing aids. And in the end, one of the main points, and also surprising, probably most surprising for me, is that purchase price didn't matter. It didn't affect any of the outcome measures. In terms of follow-up studies, what would we do next? So there's always an issue when you do research. You want the study to be as tight scientifically as possible. That's called good internal validity. But you do that at the expense of what's called external validity, your ability to generalize. So we used one type of hearing aid, one brand and make of hearing, model of hearing aid. So one of the questions is, well, would this work for all kinds of hearing aids or even over-the-counter devices? So generalizing to other types of instruments. We did have this front end where they had the full audiological evaluation. Is that necessary? Our particular study sample was primarily white, middle to upper middle class, highly educated. So are the results that we got, the positive outcomes, are they dependent on that particular sample? And if you change the demographics, would you get different outcomes? I was actually kind of surprised that of the 55, I think, who started in the consumer decides approach, we were worried about, and that's why we provided a video and then written instructions in different manuals and tried to make it as step-by-step clear as possible, whether older people could in fact follow those instructions. And I think of the 55, only four couldn't and withdrew from the study because they just thought it was too complicated. They didn't want to fiddle with it. They'd rather have somebody else, you know, pick the hearing aid for them, basically. So that might have been because our group was so highly educated, and maybe if, so anyway, trying to get to generalization to other demographics, including race, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, but also education level and background. The fact that I got the support from NIDCD, it's expensive research that just wouldn't have been possible without some federal support. I wouldn't have been able to do it through IU alone, through my university alone. Definitely needed to have costs covered to do this, and so the grant support. And then the other main thing is that it really was a big team effort.